found a ship going to Tarshish, and so he paid the fare thereof and went down into it to go with them into Tarshish. And the Bible says twice in that passage of Scripture, that verse, to go from the presence of the Lord.
Right.
I want to talk to you today about decisions.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Everybody say decisions.
Decisions.
Let's pray, shall we? Lord, we love you so much. Thank you, Lord, for your touch in our lives. God, we feel your presence, have felt your presence in this place, Lord, from the very moment that we entered into this building. Lord, for the, I know, Jesus, that you can come into a home. I know that you can touch us at work. I know, Lord, that you can be with us all the time. But, Lord, there's something special about your people joining themselves together, Lord, in a place that they have designated as a place of worship. And so, Lord, I thank you, Jesus, for your presence in this place. And just as much as on the day of Pentecost, when your word says that you came in and filled all the house where they were sitting, Lord, you have entered into this house. And Jesus, you have touched each one of us through the worship and praise. I thank you, Jesus. I pray, Lord, that we might have lifted you up. Jesus, that we will have blessed you, Lord, with our giving of ourselves and removing from our minds of all those things that would distract us from having a relationship with you. God, in centering our hearts and minds on you today, I pray that that will have blessed you as we worship you. We desire so very much, Lord, that not only our lives, but our words and our worship will always, Jesus, bless you. I pray, Lord, your anointing will remain in this house. God, that you will just touch each one of those that are within the sound of my voice today. God, that you will give us a willingness to make the decisions that will change our lives always for the better. God, I pray that you will anoint me as I preach. Lord, you know me. I need you. I need you today more than ever in my life, Lord, more than I did at the beginning. God, as we approach the end times, Jesus, I desire and want and need, Lord, your presence and your anointing in my life to be greater each and every day. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, the Lord. Yes, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, the Lord, yes, the Lord, yes, the Lord. I love you. Worship you.
Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Do you feel His presence here right now?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hey, you may be seated in Jesus' name. The Bible talks almost from the very beginning of creation until the very end of Revelation in God's Word about the choices that we make with our lives. We're constantly confronted by so many different choices. We're confronted by choices to do right, to do wrong. We see that Joshua, towards the end of his life, he stood before the children of Israel after he had led them into the promised land. And he said, I have given before you a choice between good and evil, between life and death. He says, but as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. He gave them all the warnings that would happen to them if they walked in a different direction. But then he made this affirmation also that he was going to choose the right life. And I would that all of us, I wouldn't be a preacher who really cared about people if I didn't preach the gospel.
That's right.
Amen.
I could preach you all kinds of things. I had a fellow one time, and I won't tell you who it was, that I sat and I talked with. He talked about that he said there were so many good things in the Bible to preach about that he hated all this preaching about judgment and different things that would happen in people's lives. And I said to this individual, I said, you know what bothers me worse? Is that I don't hear any preaching anymore about the options and the choices that we have.
Yeah.
And I do know that the Bible does talk about options and it talks about choices. And this passage of scripture, of course, that I read to you from today, tells of a man who is needed that he make a decision. His decision is to either do what God says or do what he wants to do.
That's right.
Those are the only two choices that he has. To do what God wants for his life or to do what he wants with his life. Now, I don't know about you, but I constantly am confronted by that same choice in my life.
Right.
I have a choice whether tomorrow I'm going to do what God wants me to do or whether I'm going to do what I want to do. And if I choose to do what I want to do, then I will step inevitably away from God's touch, direction, and anointing in my life. It may not happen instantly. It may not happen overnight. It may be that God will continue to walk with me for a while on that choice that I made, constantly working in my life to try and direct me back to that path that he has called me to. But the end result is, if I choose that other road, that road of self-will, that road that says I'm going to live the way that I want to live, sooner or later I will separate myself by too big of a gulf to cross over instantly, but without making my way a long ways back. And so it is that the Bible says that the word of the Lord came unto this man by the name of Jonah. Understand this, Jonah was a prophet. He was God's called man. He was the one that was supposed to deliver the word of God to the people that were around him. And Jonah probably thought within himself that he was doing a good job of that. He probably did. But God wants to change a little bit of the direction of Jonah's life. And so the word of the Lord came to Jonah that he was to go to Nineveh. I would dare say today, y'all excuse my voice, I always determine at the beginning of every service that I'm not going to worship loudly to save my voice from the preaching. Something about it that we get to singing and worshiping that I just can't do that. And so I find myself still making a joyful noise unto the Lord in the midst of our worship. So by the time I get to the preaching, my voice is not quite what it was at the beginning of the sermon. But I still try and make that determination. The word of the Lord came to this man, Jonah. I would dare say today that all of you are here today and have heard God speak to you to some effect or not. That God has spoken to all of you to some degree. And whether God has spoken to you through the preaching of the word, and I know what the Bible said, that we're saved through the preaching. Bible says that, foolishness of preaching.
Right.
Now, just so you understand, not foolish men that are preaching.
Right.
But the foolishness of preaching. And you want to know something? God has chosen to choose, and this always bothers me, the weak.
Yeah.
The strengthless. All of those things that he would call to exalt. Whenever I get feeling good about a sermon I preach, God always reminds me of that. Ron Nickel, I chose you because you were weak. And there's a reason that God chose us for those, because he does not want us relying on our own strength.
That's right.
Amen. So we know that we're saved by the foolishness of preaching. But there are other ways that God speaks into our hearts. God can come to you in the middle of the night. He can wake you up and you will hear his voice clearly coming into your consciousness. God will speak to you in such a way that you will understand that this is a different direction for your life. I remember one of my brothers said this. He was struggling in his walk with God and struggling with his belief. And he had to know that God was real. He made his way from British Columbia. He went to Winnipeg, where we have lots of relatives. He was staying in a hotel room. He says, God, if you're real, reveal yourself to me today. And he said, just as clearly as if there was somebody in the room, he felt a hand resting upon his head in that hotel room as he was by himself and felt the direction of God. Now, I want you to know something today. He's not living for God. Do you think that unless he turns his life around and gives himself over to what God wants with his life, that when he comes to that place of judgment, that God will remind him of that hotel room?
That's right.
And that day when he placed his hand upon his head, and my brother knew that God existed.
Right.
make. Jonah is given a choice. He is called to a place that is wicked. I don't know how else to describe it. And Nineveh's very existence was so far away from God that there were some things that God was trying to do in that city. And you know what? Those people would constantly, again and again, reject God's preachers and reject what God had for them, the direction that God had for them. And so much so that God would send prophets, and they would kill the prophets in all manner of different ways. So it's not surprising to me that when God says to Jonah, I want you to go to Nineveh, that Jonah says, not me, God. But there's another reason that Jonah doesn't want to go to Nineveh. Because you see, and I thought about this, and it just occurred to me as I was studying this. Perhaps there was a prophet that Jonah knew. Perhaps he had a friend of his that had already been called to Nineveh, and those that were at Nineveh had killed that prophet that went there.
Yeah.
Do you not think it's possible of all the men that God called to that city that Jonah wouldn't have known at least one of them? And they killed him. So Jonah's whole attitude, and I've always wondered about this, how can a man of God, a prophet of God, get in his mind that he wants a city to be destroyed? Think about it. He did not want them to repent. This God-called man had reached a place in his life of bitterness and anger where he did not want repentance.